Austria-Hungary was in an arms race with the emerging power of Germany in the late 1800s. With the adoption of the Mauser 7184 repeating rifle, the dual monarchy finally had to respond. Hi, I'm Othais, and this, this is the Repeatergewehr Model 1886, the first of the Mannlicher straight pulls. Let's get it over into the light box. Weighing in at 10 pounds and an overall length of 52 inches, this is an old world long rifle. It chambers the 11mm Verndel cartridge, albeit with some extra heat. It was the first to feed its 5 rounds from an end block clip. Now, if there's one thing that you guys have probably learned over the course of this series, is that every gun requires context. And this is a very important gun. And so we are going to need to take a step back and talk about the parent company that oversaw its development, not just the man. And we're going to start with a name, might be a little unfamiliar, but we're going to end on one that everyone I'm sure knows. This is Leopold Verndel. Born in 1797, he is not quite the focus of our story today. What we care about is that he established a shop in 1821 in Steyr, producing muskets, barrels, blades, and rifle parts for other factories. By the 1840s, he would employ 500 people. Cholera would take him in 1855, leaving his sons, Joseph and Franz, to run the company. Franz, the older brother, would handle the financial side of things, but Joseph had an eye for innovation. Born in 1831, he apprenticed as a gunsmith. During his required military service, he would meet another technically minded man by the name of Karl Holub. They became fast friends, and later, Karl would serve as the superintendent of the Verndel factory. Now back at home, Joseph would push his father to modernize the family factory, away from the old-style guild system. But he was traditionally minded and stubborn. They fought repeatedly, and so Joseph left to seek his own way. He would spend a year touring the U.S., observing the most modern manufacturing methods at Colt, Remington, and Pratt & Whitney. When he returned home to Austria, he began to set up his own shop. But that's about the time his father passed away, and he inherited the business along with his brother. With dear old dad out of the way, Joseph would finally modernize the company, and in part of that, he would bring in things like steam power and better American-made precision machinery. As again, in 1863, he would return to America, and this time he would spend about a year again looking at serial production methods. We're talking like sort of assembly line things. This is really the new technology of that day. Now, as part of that, he would also see a lot in the way of the early innovations in breech-loading metallic cartridge rifles, and he would bring that knowledge back with him to Austria. And about that same time, he and his brother would change the name of the factory to Joseph und Franz und Sia. I really can't pronounce this, guys, but let's try Waffenfabrik and Sagemühl. Forget it. You know I can't speak German. He named it blah 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 and sawmill. Alright, the names are in place, so what about the events? Well, another lesson from this series is always to remember, watch out for Prussia, holy crap. This time it was the Seven Weeks War, in which the Dreiser rifle, surprise surprise, soundly crushed the existing Austrian muzzle-loading Lorenz. In response, the Empire would adopt the Wanzel breech-loader conversion system, and begin reworking those Lorenz muskets. As part of this, the Verndels would get a contract for some 80,000 pieces, although that would change. You see, good old Karl Holub had worked out his own breech-loading action, and presented it to the military. Deemed superior to the Wanzel, it was adopted in July of 1867. Verndel had let his friend keep the patent rights, but he required exclusive production by his own factory, so history will remember this gun as the Verndel. As it just so happens, I have one of those right here. Although we are not going into detail about this particular single-shot breech loader today, they will be present in the Great War, so look forward to a future episode. 100,000 of these would be ordered through Verndel's company, along with another 150,000 order on top of that. These are huge numbers, and so Joseph can't really keep up. He needs to expand, and to do that, he needs capital, and for capital, well, in 1869, he would form a joint stock company. You might recognize the name of that new firm, Österreichische Waffenfabriks Gesellschaft, which I'm sure I butchered, often simplified to O with a little umlaut, that's the two dots, guys, WG, or as it is more popularly known by its location, Steyr. The new facilities would be world class, and they would begin not only producing for the dual monarchy, but also for foreign powers as well. There's no need to waste all this machinery, sort of similar to the story of FN. Anyway, one thing that Steyr or OWG did that was really interesting and unique to them is that they produced a number of widely varying and not remotely interchangeable guns right from the get-go, because in these early years, we are going to see production of the Bavarian Werder, we're going to see Graz for Greece, we're going to see the Mauser for Germany. OWG would run all out for the first decade. It was doing amazing in terms of expansion. We're talking about rising to the point of some 6,000 employees and pushing out roughly 13,000 rifles a week, which is very impressive. But, and it's hard to get a good estimate on this, but roughly, the needs of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which was really like the largest army in Europe at that time, standing army, they're going to push for about 300,000-ish rifles. And that's a lot, but it's still finite. And if you want to get a bigger market, you've got to go outside the country. And if you go outside the country, you have to compete. And by the late 1870s, there's a lot to compete with. We're seeing designs come out of Germany, the U.S., Britain. These are all designs that you guys are going to be familiar with in other episodes, either past or to come, but they're nibbling away at the potential for OWG to turn an extra profit or expand, which they have to do to keep those employees in place. So, luckily for everyone who banked their income on this particular factory, good old Joseph Werndl was still a visionary, and he saw that the repeating rifle revolution was around the corner. And one of his early attempts to sort of corner that market was to acquire a factory in 1871 from one Frewerth, and along with it, his Frewerth rifle. These very early repeating rifles were advanced, but somewhat fragile and very complicated. They would be adopted by the Austro-Hungarian Gendarmerie, but did not see general military use, which ultimately makes that acquisition something of a minor failure. However, it does show us, archaeologists that we are, that this is a man who is looking properly to the real future of firearms. Now, obviously, outnumbered police officers, well, militarized police officers, who had to deal with large unruly mobs, they need as much firepower as they can get. There's no reason to hinder them and make them obey all these minor orders because they are up against an unregulated and unruly force. Whereas the military, well, everything's in a line and it's quite orderly and all of our enemies, of course, will behave as well. That's the gentlemanly thing to do. So there's no reason to move away from the marksman-friendly, ammunition-saving single-shot rifles, is there? Well, of course, we know that's not true, and there's going to be obvious advantages to the repeaters eventually. And at the same time, those single-shot Werndls were not turning out to be the best single-shot rifle out there anyway. They could stand to be replaced. And we're going to do a whole episode on these guys, but just know the big three is that, one, they were subject to a lot of fouling. Two, they had problems with extraction, which had a lot to do with part three, which is relevant today. The casings on the ammunition were quite weak and prone to tearing. They spent a number of years tinkering with the Kropatschek system, ultimately declining it. That is another rifle that will get its own episode soon. Honestly, at this point, it really feels like the commission doesn't want to make a decision. I mean, you are talking about an overhead of 300,000 units plus. So any decision you make is going to be grilled in the future. It's make or break. Now, the best thing that they could possibly get in their minds was a somehow magazine conversion of the Werndl system, because that would enable them to reuse this old stock. And we know in hindsight that's not possible, but it's not weird for them to think or hold out for it, because that's how they got to the point of breech loaders, was converting muzzle loaders. So there's a pattern there for them anyway. But if you want to get around that sort of deadlock of we must reuse what we have, then you'd have to be as wise as Joseph Verndel was and go for something so overwhelmingly better that they would have to acknowledge its inherent superiority over any potential enemy of the Empire, and therefore making it valuable to purchase outright regardless of the cost. It has to be an obvious decision. And so it's lucky for good old Joseph that he would find himself employing one Ferdinand Mannlicher, a German expatriate. Born in 1848 in the German state of Hesse Castle, no relation to those little trucks they used to sell, in this pre-unification period, Mannlicher and many others saw Vienna as the heart of the German people. He would move there at the age of 17, following his father's death. Studying mechanical engineering at Vienna Technical University, he would seek employment in the railway industry. He was extremely successful there, rising to the position of chief engineer for the Imperial Northern Railroad and receiving state honors. In 1876, he would attend the Centennial Exposition in Philadelphia and become fascinated with the latest in small arms development. Returning to Austria, he would immediately switch careers. Joseph Verndel would meet and see the obvious potential in Mannlicher, and so he hired him sometime around 1877. He would quickly be put in charge of research and development for OWG's next military rifle. Ferdinand Mannlicher would throw himself whole body, whole soul, into his new career change. So, he would look down that line like everybody else and see that the repeating rifle was the next step. And in that regard, I don't know that anybody's fielded a wider variety of ideas in that period, not one person. You see a lot of inventors with good notions and they work them up start to finish, but this is a guy who would tackle something from 9 different directions, and whichever one or two had promise, he'd then work those up. So you get a wide base of attempts at him trying to worm his way at an overall goal, as we're going to see in the magazine systems. Now, at that time, probably the most common magazine is going to be the tube loader, and we've talked about that all the way back to the Lebel. Big problems with those are shifting balance, shifting point of aim, effects on precision, general delicacy, and then there's that tip to primer. I don't think that one's a very big deal at all, though. Some people worry about it more than I really think they should. Anyway, he's no exception. He would experiment with tube loaders, including like multi-tube rotating loaders to get more capacity. A lot of this, though, was done to sort of placate military authorities and just sort of bid for an adoption, because that's what was familiar to people. His real genius comes through in his alternative designs. In 1881, he would have a rifle feeding from a detachable, single-stack magazine. Soldiers were expected to carry spare magazines on their person for the purpose of reloading rapidly. That means one rifle and multiple quick-change magazines, springs, followers, and all. Now, a lot of you are probably thinking, dear Lord, the detachable quick-change magazine that we are used to today, the standard for today in military arms, was developed by a man in 1881 and completely ignored. Well, yes, but no. People recognized that that was a good idea. They really did. The problem is, again, orders of magnitude. You cannot simply produce 300,000 rifles with 50 magazines each. And yeah, the average soldier isn't going to need 50, but by the time it's been serving for 20 years, these things are going to get banged up, lost, they're just going to need replacing constantly. And so it's an ongoing expense when you could otherwise just adopt a different gun and just pay the money once, and it's done, and it's out of your budget. They're not used to these sort of maintenance fees on individual components of a gun, and by the way, at that time, the spring and follower setup, the pressings for the magazine, that sort of thing, that's very, very, very new technology, and it's expensive to produce. It's not quite throwaway. I mean, you would have to actually take some care with these things. So, excellent concept, technologically impossible execution at that time. But it does mean that Mannlicher had a mind towards having a soldier with a lot of ammunition in place, not just in a repeating rifle, which is what everybody else is sort of working on. They're working on just repeating rifles. Well, we're talking about 1881. He's not working on just a repeating rifle. He's working on a quick load repeating rifle. He wants to have whole magazines of ammo ready to go as fast as you can load a single round or faster. This is an excellent concept, and we're going to see him push it further. Attempt number two would follow in 1882, and it would look much simpler. This was a gravity-fed hopper-style magazine. This way, the manufacturing costs could be kept down, no spring, and hopefully still allow troops to carry those whole spare magazines on their person. In this first iteration, it was paired with a regular turn-bolt action that he had designed. The 1882 still didn't garner much attention from the authorities, who were still moving at a snail's pace, but that would soon change. You see, Germany would finally adopt their repeating rifle, the Mauser 7184, which used an Austro-Hungarian familiar, that Kropatschek magazine. This would get them off their collective keisters. That little upstart empire was not going to be beating the Austro-Hungarians with their own dang design. Nuh-uh, not this time. As a matter of fact, we're getting off our butts right now, and we're going to adopt a gun. It's going to be better than your gun. We don't know what it is yet, but we're doing it, and it's going to be cool, and you're going to be so jealous. Oh, I can't believe they did that. All right, so now the commission is finally ready to get to work, and they're going to review a lot of designs. You're going to see familiar names like Winchester and Spencer and Gosser. You're going to see Lee and Schronauer. You're also going to see some other guys like Odkolek and like Schulhoff and things like that. And of course, right in the middle of it, our guy Mannlicher. Old Dirty Ferdy had kept that hopper magazine. He was still determined to give the soldiers a pile of ready magazines. I love Mannlicher. The problem is, gravity feeds are crap. But in this model, the 84, he would introduce a straight pull action that had the commission sitting up and paying attention. There was a distinct advantage to the straight pull system. It was one less motion for the human hand, and it was easier to manipulate prone or otherwise hiding. Plus, it didn't interrupt the sight of the shooter. This 1884 design used a bolt cylinder with helical grooves set inside a corresponding bolt body. By throwing the bolt forward, the bolt cylinder would be spun 90 degrees, turning lugs on its side into mortises in the receiver, locking the action. The commission still hated that gravity feed magazine, and for good reason. They're stupid. I'm sorry, guys. They're just dumb. Anyway, the bolt they were more fascinated by, but it doesn't mean that they approved of it. As a matter of fact, they found it incredibly overcomplicated and expensive to manufacture. There was no way that this thing was going to run well in a military rifle. And there's also some fears about its fine fitting with the black powder cartridges of the day. I mean, you really have to avoid that fouling issue. That's why those lugs are so far back in that diagram. Well, they encouraged Mannlicher, please, if you find a way around these problems, bring it back to us. And wouldn't you know, this man, who I love so much, did just that. And not by simplifying the action. This is the part in every other episode where I say, and then he simplified the action, or he lightened the action, or yada yada. No. He invents an entirely different gun, but is still a straight pull. Now, we're using a wedge locker. Here, the bolt handle is attached to an inner cylinder with an underhanging wedge. Two ridges on either side of that wedge ride in corresponding grooves set into a pivoting block, which is attached to the underside of the bolt body. When the handle is pressed forward, the block is forced down, locking the action shut. When retracted, it is yanked up, unlocking the action. Boom! Bolt locking problem solved. Rapidly. Not only that, but he still had to address that terrible magazine system that nobody quite cared for. He didn't just find something okay. He didn't just dig out a tube loader so that, you know, he could sell the thing. No. He was determined. Again, I can't strike this home enough. He was determined to appropriately arm the infantry. He wanted them to have ready-to-go personal magazines. And so he would stop, and if you take a moment and look, just really think about this for a second. You have a magazine system. It's got a spring, a follower, some feed lips, a way to contain the ammo, and it has to line up with the bolt of the gun, okay? Those are the elements. And you can see that he has all of them in one package, and he tries to sell that, and they say no. And then he takes away all the interior, and then tries to sell just that sort of, like, the holding of the magazine, and then he flips it upside down to get rid of the spring, and hopefully this is going to be enough to give a whole magazine to the troops. And no, that's not going to work either. Okay, so he knows he needs a spring and follower. He can't get away from that, so it's got to be on the underside of the gun. And he's already worked with trying to get a separate box that just does nothing. So he ends up going, okay, I have to have the box, I have to have the springs and follower, I have to have all that stuff in the magazine. What can I possibly take out of the magazine? Well, what he took out were the feed lips and the retention system. And that would become the end block. Five rounds were held in a spring clip that also served to control the cartridges during feeding in the magazine. The whole thing was inserted into the magazine hole, where a catch held the clip. The follower fit between the wings of the clip, feeding rounds upwards while it was still locked in place. When the last cartridge was fed, the follower pressure was released from the clip, allowing it to fall just enough to free that back side of the catch lever, whose far side up under the clip would then fling upwards, throwing the clip out of the action vertically. Huh. Where have we seen that before? Those two combined form the Mannlicher 1885 rifle, and 5,500 of these would be manufactured for field trials. They would be tested intensively for 1 year, and in that time, a few improvements and mostly simplifications were made. It was paired with the traditional 11mm Verndel black powder cartridge, which would then be beefed up from 1,400 feet per second to 1,600. Because of weaknesses in the old cartridge, the head and rim were also reworked and strengthened to prevent that old tearing problem. And that leads us, adopted in January of 1897, to this guy, the Model 1886, Austria-Hungary's first official repeater, the first unblock rifle, and honestly, a lovely, lovely machine. Alright, so now that we know what it is that I'm holding, let's get a look at the details. Alright, first of all, first and foremost, this is a straight pull rifle, and it's a very, very easy and smooth one. I can do this very slowly with not a lot of force. It's quite wonderful. Just while I'm back here, let's talk about this very simple safety. All it does is turn in behind the bolt handle and in front of the cocking piece. Therefore, the cocking piece can't go forward and the bolt handle can't come back. Awesome. All right. Now we see our extended single stack magazine here. That is going to load, like I said, from a very large end block clip. Now these are one directional. They have to go in one way, most likely avoiding rim lock on the back of these rim cartridges. Now, if you're feeling around in the dark for one of these, there's a set of ridges up here. On the earliest versions, they are very shallow or perhaps just worn out. Later on, they're going to be more pronounced. You'll see another version of this clip later, but the originals like this are, you know, fully formed, solid, thin steel. All right, and again, these are big black powder cartridges. All right, looking back at the action, we're going to see that we have a beautiful, fully adjustable rear sight. This pattern and shape we're going to see on many other designs, and you're also going to see them wander into things like the Dutch style guns because they'll be licensed through Steyr. So it's not an unfamiliar sight for a lot of countries at this point. The other thing that we do have, if I bring your attention down here, is there's a stud right there. Can you guys make that out? Actually, tell you what, patented plastic pokey hand. There it is, right there. Okay, that guy is aligned with, check this guy's out, this is sweet, that guy. That, with a notch right here, whoop, right there, lines up with this guy up here for our volley sight. Beautiful. Oh, and I also should say, while we're talking about these sights, do not think that these numbers are actually metric, because they are the old Schritt Imperial system. And I guess they kind of roughly equate to a meter, but so does a yard, so you know what that's worth. Alright, getting on down the other end of the gun, we have a stacking rod so you can make your rifle teepee, and we have a side mount bayonet lug. This would fit a knife style bayonet. Alright, wrapping up on the overall tour of the gun, on this Mannlicher end block clip system, I'm gonna unload this clip because these guys are legit cartridges. Normally I have dummies made up for you guys, so let's just whop. Okay, there we go. Boink. The clip would be inserted wholly with ammunition into the gun, and it would depress the follower. And then we would chamber each round one by one, and then when they're all done, it's able to just sort of pass right through the entire system. So, pong, just like that. Now that's when the last round is chambered. Keep an eye out on it when you're looking at Mae later. All right, to take this gun apart, all we have to do is pull on this left side release, that should be familiar to a lot of you, and give it a rather hearty yank. And then it pinches your finger every freaking time. Okay, now we can see, let me get this guy out of the way. Oh, there we go. We can see our wedge locker, and it's very easy to demonstrate this gun. If I just pull this to the rear, you can see that that guy clicks right up under there. And then if I let it go forward, drops on down. Simple as pie. These bolts are a little tricky to take apart, but I'll still go ahead and show it to you because it's not quite that bad. First of all, you want to get the extractor off, which you just have to give it a good little wiggle. As a matter of fact, if your bolt's back, it helps because it's retained by catch in there. And then I'll make a liar out of myself and have to do a time lapse. Sorry guys, time lapse. I got a little snagged and I didn't want to sit there and wrestle it on camera with my arms fully extended, so I pulled it to my chest. But all I really did was get a little bit of tension up under there, push it out and to the rear. See how that locks right there? All right, so we can unscrew our bolt face. And again, another quick time lapse because honestly, I just didn't want you guys to see me having to smack at that a little bit with a rubber mallet. These can get a little seized. Generally though, if you've been in them more recently than this, they come right off. All right, so if we're at the back of the gun, we can now, and this is where you need to have either an appropriately sized spare casing, or I like these little Enfield bolt tools because we've got to get up and over that bolt, or up and over that firing pin, and then push down, which is not going to appear well in camera, I'm sorry to say. So let me see if I can twist this back and just do this so you can see it. I'm popping this guy out the back. See what I'm doing there? He's coming out, and then he's going to spin so that I can unscrew him. So I'm gonna put it back up and do that real quick and you'll get another time lapse. Okay. Oh. So I've spun this guy off of the rear of the firing pin. Okay. And I'm sorry for all the time lapses on this guys, but it's a little bit of a struggle on these guys. All right, so this just slides out. This guy's hanging here. You by all means could press that pin out. I'm not doing it because I would rather this thing stay in firing condition. As a matter of fact, I'm pretty sure it's a ground screw. So I would leave the wedge alone unless you really have to play with it. But at this point, we can see how simple this is. We have a bolt body with a wedge or with a block. And then we have this guy who's fairly complicated shape, but one piece. Then we have a screw on cocking piece, firing pin and spring, a separate bolt face and an extractor. So not really all that complicated for a very early straight pull rifle. And it's extremely light and smooth and easy to use. All right, with that struggle complete, I always tear up my hands, guys. Let's go ahead and get this thing over to Mae and see how it does on the range.
All right, we'll load up our 5-round M block clip. Slap that bolt forward. And the safety is extremely simple. Watch for that clip to drop now. All right, let's slow her down. Let's see how I did. Not bad for how heavy it is. Okay, let's let Othais do his thing.
You know, everybody's jealous of Mae until they find out that she has to stand there for hours on end, not leaving her spot so that all the cameras stay on the same focus point, and she has to constantly be refreshed while we get the ammo and other features dialed in, and we go through a bunch of different rifles, so I actually mean it when I say thank you. Anyway, these guns would be ordered to the tune of 143,000, which delighted OWG Steyr, and would roughly replace half of what was inventory for the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and it looked like they were going to go on to the other half, certainly, because they were doing wonderfully, except for those dang this time it was the French. Later that same year, we know from our first episode, they released the LaBelle 1886 and its revolutionary smokeless powder cartridge. The Empire's brand new spiffy rifle was now obsolete. That means production for these guys were halted already in that same year, with only 90,000 completed out of that initial contract. Which is kind of a disappointment, I'm sure, but it also means that, you know, good old OWG has to remanufacture a bunch of guns, because the one thing Austria-Hungary was not going to do is not have a smokeless powder gun. So the only problem with that, keeping up with this small bore, high velocity, smokeless powder revolution, is that they didn't have any smokeless powder. They were way behind the curve on that front. And so they would have to go for 2 out of 3. In 1888, they'd introduce an 8mm cartridge using compressed black powder to close on the French as best as possible, managing a still impressive 1,750 feet per second. But making a lot of mess. Now, of course, that ammo would rattle around a little bit in this big old 11mm bore, so they were forced to get rid of the 1886, or rather convert them, along with a new made rifle. Oh, this! The Repetergewehr 1888. And I'm lying through my teeth because this is an 8890. I'll show you the difference in just a moment. Weighing in at 9.9 pounds and with an overall length of 50 and nearly 1/2 inch, we're not saving much on size. It still uses a 5-round end block feed. The chamberings get a little tricky. Now about that lie, you see, the pure Mannlicher 1888s and those 86s that would indeed be converted to this rifle pattern just by some changes to the magazine, replacing the barrel, updating the sights, yada yada, you get the idea. They chambered the Scharfpatron 1888 compressed black powder cartridge, but almost immediately, I mean 2 years, which is not a lot of time when you're talking about a century of history, in 2 years, it would be replaced with an almost smokeless powder cartridge. Now we have a near identical round with a 2mm longer case. This time, the bullet is moving at a much more acceptable 1,950 feet per second. The 1890 cartridge only required a simple modification to the chamber and new markings for the rear sight, which were bolted on with sheet steel. So now, just about every 1886 and 1888, which this technically isn't because you'll see in a second, they would all be converted up to that new 1890 cartridge, making this the 1888-90, and if this had been converted, it would be an 86-90. Sorta. Names get a little tricky here, but just know it all rolls over. Anyway, we end on the 1888-90. This is the last of the wedge lockers. We'll get into the rest in another episode. All right, so if I make some room, whoop. Oh, hold on, these guys are really big. Who'd have thunk? I'm gonna set one off to the side here and try not to break my wrist. And then I'm gonna set this one on the table. All right, so overall, smaller than the previous. As a matter of fact, let's do the daring thing and bring it back up. There's a very slight scale difference in those magazines. It's actually not as surprising as you would defined as you would think. Sights are basically the same with modifications for different Schritt, and otherwise no big changes here except for a little bit of length and obviously the new cartridge, which also took a smaller clip. So if I can give you a comparison there, there's our old one, which will not stand up on its own, I'm learning. There we go. And here is our newer one, although this is a reload, and this is, well, it's also a reload, but it's a better original style cartridge. So you can see big difference. All right, so let's get these out of the way. It's going to use the same exact clip system, although I do not have the specific 88-88-90 clips. Instead, I have this original 86. But if you imagine this scaled down to be the same size as the later 95, that's all it is. It's just this without the hole cut out. And we'll get to these later. All right, magazine works the same. Nothing to really talk about there. Safety works the same. Nothing to talk about there. The one thing is, let's just look at that clip plate. I showed you in the photo before, but just for anybody who wants to see it kind of up close, you can see that sort of ridge in there, that line where it's been clipped over. And that's really about the whole story. All right, I know that was very scant, so let's see if I can make it up to you with a proper animation. First, we'll drop in our end block clip, completing the magazine assembly. The follower pushes up on the lowest cartridge, while the highest pushes up on the inside of that clip, keeping it locked against the catch at the rear. Now let's watch that bolt. As it drives forward, it will force the underside block downwards, locking into the receiver. When retracted, it will draw the block back up, unlocking the action. The safety, as I said, is a simple circular wedge, which blocks the cocking piece from moving forward and the bolt from moving back. Looking at the magazine again, we'll see the follower continue to rise as the cartridges are freed, until the last one is chambered, and the follower passes through the clip, which now falls free out of the action. With that wrapped up, let's take this over to May.
I think we know what to do here. That recoil is a bit sharper. Same easy on, easy off safety. Delightful. About the same as before, but the holes are smaller. Okay, back to Othais.
Two thank yous today for May. Awesome. All right, so I do need to kind of backtrack just a bit, because between 88 and the 90, we do have to mourn the loss of one Joseph Werndl, who would pass in April of 1889 due to pneumonia. Now, at this point, OWG Steyr is the largest manufacturer of small arms in the world. You are talking about 10,000 employees, 800,000 outstanding rifle contracts. This is a big deal, big firm, and so the directors would need to pick a new manager. And it's worth mentioning in this episode, because we're going to see him later, that that man would be one Otto Schonauer. Returning to the Mannlichers, these guys are going to see fairly good exports. You're going to see them in places like Chile and Bulgaria. You're going to see them in China and Thailand and various other nations. And in order to know who rather received them rather than staying at home in Austria-Hungary, it's very easy. You can just check the back of that safety. Just look at the back of that bad boy and see if you got one of these two marks. And that will tell you that they were purpose-made for not Austria-Hungary. They were sent overseas. Now, these are actually fairly common in anything other than an 1890 pattern, because these are really the only guns that managed to escape the 1890 updates. So if you have an original 86 or an 88 that does not have this mark, then you just hit the jackpot, because It's very, very hard to find them not updated. Now, I know a lot of you might not be intimately familiar with the incredibly, incredibly bizarre political situation that was the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Believe me, it was a boiling pot even at this point. And part of that, though, is going to go over to the Hungarian side, who is pushing harder and harder for regional autonomy. And as part of that, in 1891, they would demand their own arms-making facility, and they would get it. And that would be Feggyver Gepgar, which I'm sure I butchered, so we'll just go with Feg, which everybody recognizes today, and I can pronounce. Anyway, Feg in Budapest, which should kind of click around for you guys. We now have OWG in Steyr and Feg in Budapest. It would produce the same guns as the other half of the empire. And you would think that those would be limited to Hungarian recruited troops, but no. Once they were all manufactured, they were thrown in the same pool and distributed fairly evenly across the country. It was just something of a point of national pride that they could develop their own. And it would be a wise decision because we know in hindsight, they would need their own arms-making facility after the war. You can tell who made your rifle by looking at the receiver, in which you'll see a small grouping of letters, either what looks like CEWG, which is actually a way of writing the umlauted OWG. That means that your gun came out of Steyr. If you see an FGGY, that's Feg out of Budapest. Now, the first real conflict for the Mannlicher Great Pool would be the Chilean Civil War of 1891. This pitted congressional rebels against the then-president José Manuel Balmaceda, who I'm probably not pronouncing right either. There's a lot of stuff to pronounce in this episode, guys. Who would commit suicide after the defeat of the Chilean army. 3,500 of these things had been shipped, intended for the powers that be, but they were intercepted by the congressional rebels, and they caught them along with their ammo. So that means they got a big old increase in firepower, especially when you consider that the most common rifle that was fielded by the entrenched troops now was the old Gras 1874. So, single-shot black powder versus semi-smokeless repeater, these things with their superior range and rapid fire dominated and probably lended a fair hand to the outcome of that particular war. The first actual battle for these working with Austria-Hungary would be during the Boxer Rebellion, though. This was the imperial social event of the century, and every army that was any army had to be there. It was so embarrassing if you didn't go and shoot at Chinese people. Now, you number counters out there and people who are already familiar with some history might note that the first Austro-Hungarian use of this gun came after it was replaced by another model, the 1895, which we'll talk about later. But these guns really had some staying power. Now, there were some weaknesses, and we're going to talk about them in more detail in the next episode, but, the powder cartridges are getting a lot hotter. They're getting a lot more powerful. This action can't handle that necessarily. It's a very one-sided, shallow. It's going to have problems with compression, and it's going to wear out a lot faster than another gun when trying to be beaten to death by those semi-smokeless and later smokeless cartridges. Well, what we can say, though, is that by 1893, we are seeing a truly smokeless cartridge. Again, more detail later. Luckily, for the Austro-Hungarians and for the 8890, they would be wise enough not to push it to the limit of their new rifle, and instead left it as something that could still be handled by this action. That means that these got to sit around in inventory or reserve use all the way until 1914, at which time war were declared. As a matter of fact, by August of 1914, inventory reported 1.5 million of these things still in operational inventory. That makes this the most numerous Austro-Hungarian rifle of World War I, not the 1895, not at the beginning anyway. Yes, production would catch up at some point, but not enough in this war of attrition to ever remove these guys from the front line. This is a front line World War I straight pull rifle, guys. That's amazing. Now, within the dual monarchy, it's all going to be 8890s, but don't forget, these things were sold into nearby Balkan nations, not just these, but the 88s and these old 86s, so it's not unreasonable to think that this is going to see some service in other smaller nations right at the beginning of the war. Maybe not for long, though, but this guy, the 8890, oh yeah, he went the whole nine yards. Anyway, these guys still suffered some problems. Like I said, they're one-sided lock, the asymmetrical lock. That means that the new smokeless cartridges are pounding on these guns, and they're going to slowly wear out. And it's not like they're going to burst or hurt anybody. That's not really the weakness of this gun. The weakness is that it deforms in there, and you get an unsupported cartridge base, and you end up with precision problems. So it's just throwing off your shot. And so they don't wear as well as other guns. They don't stay in the front line as long as other guns. And, of course, they had that dirty magazine hole that we've talked about before. Now, there is one definitive problem with this particular gun by design, which is that because we do not have a rotating, slightly tapered camming unlock, we just have this yank. And literally the bolt face just goes straight back. There's no rotation, there's no torque applied. This gun lacks primary extraction. And so, poor ammo, cold conditions, those sorts of things, you get some chamber binding. The good thing about it being a straight pull, though, you can kick that sucker open. Although then you risk tearing up that case. Either way, that's not the worst of the worst things that you can have wrong with your gun. Now, with the end of the war, these guys aren't going to see a lot of use afterwards, although there will be some. You see, as Austria-Hungary broke up, they would have to disperse what they had in inventory as reparations to other nations. There would be so many arms on the market, though, that these old guys, with their little inferiorities, it just pushed them off the line. I mean, you could pick from some of the best guns of World War I because everybody had surplus. I mean, look at all the German surplus. Look at the M95 surplus. So these things tend to retire, although there was one attempt, very oddly, to resurrect them. At some point, some jackass rechambered these guns for 7.92 by 57 millimeter Mauser, a cartridge they certainly should not handle over time. They were also shortened, given a handguard, and fitted with a Nagant-style rifle rear sight. While we're not sure who the intended recipient was, it's been reported that some turned up in Greek hands during World War II. If you find one, please do be careful. Alright, on that note, let's get Mae in here to give us a review. Alright, we made room for Mae, and didn't quite make room for these. They're huge. We'll talk more about that in a moment. Alright, so we have in her hands the 1886 black powder. We have in my hands the 8890 semi-smokeless, or we'll just go ahead and say smokeless rifle over here on the right. So, there's not going to be a lot of back and forth with these guys, or we're going to end up knocking down half the wall. So use your imaginations where possible, but there's really not a lot of difference anyway. So let's just go straight into it and talk about the ergonomics.
All right, first and foremost, I want to mention, this is an incredibly long gun, very heavy. And did I mention it was long? However, it's fairly well balanced. It actually isn't too bad ergonomics-wise. So actually, I didn't mind it too much. However, I could see if I was marching around with this all day, I could understand if it would get a little bit tiresome, but if I'm just resting or like having fun with it or even going prone, I could actually understand this being all right to handle. Now, next I want to point out is the magazine. This juts out pretty far. I was anticipating maybe like accidentally banging into it or something like that, but while being on range, it didn't actually give me any problems. However, I could see if I had the strap to my back, it would bang against my back a little bit. So could see potential problems with it jutting out this far. Just me personally, didn't give me any grief. Next up I want to talk about is the wrist. Now, it is a semi-pistol grip by 86. Thank you, guys! Austrians were awesome with that. Yet here we got the 88. No pistol grip. Come on, guys. They got 2 years on you. What? Jerks. Anyway. But seriously, I appreciate the pistol grip. I personally think it helps mitigate recoil, and it's just kind of nice to have that full finger grip on the rifle where it doesn't feel like you're going to slip on it. Fantastic. Next up, I want to talk about the action. Now, there is a little bit of resistance at the beginning, but once you break that seal, So smooth. I can appreciate that so much. So for me, love the action, and honestly, love straight pulls. I mean, I've shot the Ross, and I love my Swiss rifles. I thought those are awesome. And this one is just a neat wedge lock system. It's different. It's not that rotating system that's in the others. So just a neat little fun fact, and I think it's kind of cool that it's different. Last, not least, I want to talk about the safety. It is a little bit stiff. I don't know if it's this one in particular, just needs a little more cleaning or whatever. But honestly, still easy to operate one-handed, so I didn't think it was a problem. So overall, ergonomics-wise, a little too long, a little too heavy, but ergonomically still pretty decent.
Yeah, overall, not the worst gun in terms of handling, except, boy, she's not kidding when she says heavy. These are among the heaviest that we've had to pull for the series so far. I don't know if they're just made out of lead or what, but they are beastly. We've had things as long that haven't weighed in quite as badly. But regardless, it's interesting to see, by the way, I know it seems odd maybe to some of you that she's being concerned about whether or not she has a flush magazine when we're in this modern era of long detachable box magazines that we're used to. But back then, that was a strong consideration. As a matter of fact, you'll even see things like over in the Netherlands, on their Mannlicher style rifles, they'd have like wood plates placed over these to keep them from ruining their uniforms while they rode on horseback or whatever. So it was a concern. And besides, you know, you say, okay, it's underslung, it goes over my shoulder, then I don't gotta worry about it rubbing up on my back or poking me, right? Yeah, you say that until you accidentally put your funny bone right on that metal ridge. That's gotta hurt. You could lose a war. All right, anyway, let's go ahead and go to the next little bit, which would obviously be firing these. I guess there's gonna be some difference, though, because we have two distinct cartridges.
Yes, and I will get to that in a moment, sir. But first and foremost, the sights. These sights, I will give them about a 6 or a 7, and here's why. So it's got the V-notch sight, but it's actually not that deep. It's medium depth, I would say. And then it has these two wings up top, which, while they're narrow and I can see around fairly easily in my opinion, I could still see them possibly getting in the way and cutting out some of your peripheral vision, which they do. So they're not great, they're not bad, 6 or a 7 in my opinion. So let's go with that. Next up, the trigger. Now, at first it feels like there's practically nothing to the take up. And then, all of a sudden, there's some heavy resistance, and you're pulling through it, and then bang, the brake goes off. I never once, while I was shooting, anticipated when the brake was actually going to happen because it was so smooth, and there was no weight difference once it hit that hard pull, which was fantastic in my opinion. So the trigger on this one was a very, very pleasant surprise. I thoroughly appreciated that. And then last, I said I would get to it, the recoil. There is a little bit of a difference, even though the recoil was just about the same, and here's why. So here I've got the black powder rifle. It's a heavier, slower cartridge, so when the recoil hits me, it just pulls back slower into my shoulder, and I don't know, it feels like it's almost like a little more natural movement. It's not like you can actually perceive like such a strong difference, except for like, I don't know, just the last little bit. It doesn't feel quite as sharp as the smokeless does, in my opinion. So this one just a little bit slower, that one just a little bit sharper. Overall, recoil was about the same though, in my opinion. But yeah, as far as shooting goes, these were actually fairly excellent. They performed really well on range too.
Yeah, all that weight does come to one distinct advantage, which is when you pull the trigger, this thing barely moves. So there's that. All right, so I guess I got to start asking that final question, but let me put it to you a little differently this time. I'll give you a two-parter. Part one, out of these two guns, as a collector of straight pulls, which would you prefer if you could only choose one to keep in your collection? Like, which would be your shooter, your enjoyable gun? And then, either, both, whatever, do you take it into the Great War or not?
I see what he's doing here, throwing in a second question. How dare you, sir? No, I'm just kidding. But, okay, so which one would I prefer to have in my collection? Me, personally, like I said, love the straight pulls, enjoy the Swiss and the Ross, so those are awesome. This one, no different. I guess I would actually pick the 86, just because, honestly, that black powder cartridge, shooting it, I thought was really nice. Like I was saying before, it almost felt like that slower recoil into your shoulder. It just it felt nicer. It felt more natural. I didn't feel like I was being jerked quite as much, which was fantastic in my opinion. And honestly, I just like the smell of black powder. So, you know, I can have my preferences. It's my collection. As far as what if I would take either into battle or, you know, if I would take, you know, one or the other, if I were forced into battle with either one of these, because of how well they performed on range, I would actually be okay with it. Because we went into the range like, and these are old and beaten up. I felt, and we all felt like they were going to give us some sort of problems, but we had no feeding problems. Everything went down to range. All shots were on paper. And even when we were having funsies afterwards, everyone was still performing well with them. So we shot these all day long and they did great. It was amazing. So if I were forced into battle, I would be okay with either one. Now, if I wanted to actually decide, like if I was given a choice, weirdly enough, just because, you know, it's black powder cartridge, I would actually give this one a soft no, whereas the smokeless, I would actually give that one a good yes, because like I said, they performed really well. However, this one with the black powder cartridges, they're just bigger and they're not going to give me as much range, whereas the smokeless will. So smaller cartridge, more range. I'm definitely going to give that one a solid yes because it just performed so well. It was awesome. But that's it, yeah.
We fully expected that both of these were going to be a no. I mean, I was planning on it.
Yeah.
So, and that's, you know, it's book knowledge. Once you get into your hand, though, you still think it's probably going to be a no. Once you start playing with it, now you're getting a little curious. And once you shoot one of these guys, never mind. Because despite coming out of 1886, I prefer that gun. Let me compare it to its sister, the LaBelle, the same year. That thing's supposed to be the smokeless revolution. And it was. It was very important. And the cartridge was magnificent. I would take that into battle over the LaBelle. I can load it faster. I'm better on target with it. I prefer that, even in black powder, to the LaBelle. However, I know logically that I should prefer to have a LaBelle in an actual combat situation. So, soft no, I agree with that guy. This guy, he hasn't made it in my top five, but he's not in the bottom 5% either. Like, he's actually a very good semi-smokeless or smokeless rifle, as later on. These guys, terrific. Total turnaround on my opinion. Hopefully we're not ruining the market, so some of you can sneak out and grab one and try it yourself, because these are probably some of the most underappreciated firearms out there right now. I love the 8890. All right, so that's going to wrap us up with sound praise for Mannlicher and his rifles. We're going to carry on into the 1895 in our next episode, and then a little bit on past that, you'll see. But I would invite everybody to stay around, especially after the credits this time, because we do have a very real update considering the holidays. That's if you're watching on time. All right, thank you all again for tuning in for our episodes. We appreciate it.
Thank you, and later, everyone.
All right, guys, you get a proper update because there are two very important things to discuss. One, there will be t-shirts for sale in the description. Go grab them. These are the per unit cost. The big thing for Germany and France is done. That was in the summer. But if you didn't get yours or you needed a size that we weren't able to do in bulk, go check now. If the size still isn't there, let me know. If I can gather enough of you, then maybe I can do something about it. It kind of depends on cost. T-shirts are very expensive on the front end to get produced, unlike our usual annual posters. And by the way, we are right in front of the Christmas season, so it's that time of year again. We are doing another poster. This time, it's going to be World War I themed, and I know you can't see it clearly, so I will pop a photo up there, and there will be a link to a better photo in the description. But this guy has a nice vintage feel. He's listing out World War I rifles for you. If you enjoy the show, if you enjoy the rifles, if you'd like some art on your walls, and if you'd like to support us financially while receiving something in return, this is the way to go. We use these funds to survive the winter season. It's been a big help every year, and with all the new subscribers, I hope that this will be the biggest year yet, and I hope that everybody enjoys these. Now, for those of you who participated in the t-shirts, you will know that how we had to collect all the money, then get the t-shirts material, then make the t-shirts, because we had no idea how many people were going to have, and the only way to make it affordable was to buy in bulk. Well, these guys, we've been doing for years straight. We have them locked down. These ship within about a week of the time that you put in your Indiegogo order. So if you want them before Christmas, go ahead and start ordering on this 1 month thing. You will get them sooner than if you order later in the month. You really will. These we are very good at. All right. Thanks a lot, guys. Check out the description for any further updates, and we appreciate it every time. Thank you.